Good evening. Welcome to the public lecture organized by the Institute for Mathematical Sciences this evening. My name is Chong Chitat. I'm the director of the Institute. This evening, we are very pleased to have a distinguished speaker for this public lecture, Professor Moshe Vardi. Professor Vardi received his PhD from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem in Israel, and spent many years subsequently at the IBM Research Center, Amalgam Center. And then he joined Rice University and is currently the Karen Astrom George Distinguished Service Professor at Rice University in Computer Engineering and Computer Science Department.
The title says computer engineering, I mean the computer science department.
Right. So Professor Vardi has had a very outstanding, a distinguished career. He's one of the leading computer scientists in the world, I should say. And he has received many, many awards as I went through his CV. But let me just mention a few. He has received the Girdle Prize from the Association for Computing Machinery, that's ACM, for his contributions. And this award was given by the what is called SIGACT, Special Interest Group in Algorithms and Computation Theory. He's also received a Cod Prize from ACM, Special Interest Group in Management of Database. So that's a SIGMOP. These are two very important conferences that have recognized his outstanding contributions to the fields. He has also received several honorary doctoral degrees and is a member of the National Academy of Engineering, U.S., a member of the National Academy of Sciences, U.S., USA, and also a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and also a fellow of the European Academy of Science. And he has written, well, or co-authored 500 papers or more, two books. And he's most, he's very well known in the field of automated reasoning, with applications to database learning, database theory, computational complexity, knowledge in multi-agent systems, and of course, program verification. Tonight, he's going to give us a talk on automated reasoning revolution from theory to practice and back. Please welcome Professor Vardi.
Thank you for the very kind introduction, and thank you all for braving the rain and coming here this evening to hear me. So I'm going to start by talking about P versus NP, which is an outstanding, probably considered to be the most outstanding open problem, at least in theoretical computer science. I mean, it's even recognized as a major problem in mathematics. In 2000, the Clay Institute defined a set of millennium problems, the Riemann hypothesis, the Poincaré conjecture, and the P versus NP question. If you need some money, just solve it. There's $1 million check waiting for you. So what is P versus NP about? It's about a concept that we call computational complexity. How hard it is to solve computational problems. This is a In 2010, there was in Washington, D.C., a rally to restore sanity about politics, and a colleague of mine went there, and he put a big sign, P versus NP, equality now. I don't know how many people understood the joke. So what is a computational problem? So let's focus on graphs. So a graph is a, some people call it network. You have a set of nodes and a set of edges or arcs connecting the nodes. It's a very basic model studied in numerous areas of computer science and applied mathematics, and of course, mathematics itself. So there are two notions of cycles. There is a Hamiltonian cycle, that a cycle that visits every node exactly once. And there's a concept of Eulerian cycle, and that's a cycle that visits every edge exactly once. Very similar sounding definitions. So you can ask, we ask, given a graph, does it have a Hamiltonian cycle? Does it have an Eulerian cycle? Can we find such cycles? Now the questions about Eulerian cycle, this is what gave rise to graph theory. So in the 18th century, Euler lived in Königsberg. Königsberg today is Kaliningrad. It is small enclave of Russia between Poland and Lithuania, but it used to be part of Prussia. And Euler lives there, and the city had the river with an island, and there were 7 bridges. And on Sunday afternoon, the citizen of Königsberg would like to take a stroll, and the question came up, can you take a stroll and cross every bridge exactly once? That was a question people couldn't figure out. So they went to Euler. He was known as a very wise guy. They went to Euler. And Euler made a fantastic abstraction. And he realized that every piece of land can be collapsed to one point. And then you get this graph. Okay? So now every piece of land is collapsed to one point, and the bridges become edges in the graph. And now the question is, does this graph has an, what we call today, an Eulerian cycle? Now, Hamilton cycle, here is an example of a graph, and Hamilton did not really study the graph theoretic problem, but there was a puzzle, and this was the solution to the puzzle. That's why today we call Hamiltonian cycle. So here you see a graph, and you see a puzzle visit every node exactly once. Now, what is computational complexity? So we ask how hard it is to solve a computational problem, such as Eulerian, finding Eulerian cycles, or Hamiltonian cycle. And so formally, the question is, how many Turing machine operations would it take to solve this problem? But it turns out that for our purpose, you don't even know what is a Turing machine. You can think how many basic computer operations, or can imagine this is x86, and it has an instruction set. How many operations does it take to solve this problem? What is the size of the input? The size of the input for a graph, let's say the number of nodes plus the number of edges. Again, this is fairly robust. And we're interested in a problem that can be solved in time that grows not too fast. What is not too fast? Polynomial, which is n to the c for some fixed degree c, as opposed to exponential would be, for example, 2 to the n would be an exponential. We're interested in n to the c, maybe n squared, n cubed, etc. And it turns out that under this measure, if you only care about how fast does it grow, it doesn't matter whether you're using x86 or ARM or any other machine. I mean, the relationship is fairly robust. Now, many problems that we are solving regularly in mathematics can be solved in polynomial time. So is a given number even? Well, very easy. You go to the last bit, the last digit, and you check whether this is even. So you can solve it in linear time. Is a number square? Now, that's less obvious. But how many people here know how to extract square root by long hand? Some people still know. They used to teach it. I don't think they teach it anymore, how to extract square root by long hand. The way you do long division, there's a long square root. And if you think about it, it's a polynomial term. It's a quadratic algorithm. Okay? And so it can be done. It's not very difficult. Maybe even linear, I think. Now, does the graph have Eulerian cycle? So Euler proved that a graph has Eulerian cycle if and only if every node has an even degree. Because every time you enter, you leave. If there is odd degree, you're going to get stuck there at some point. Now this graph, you can see we have many nodes with odd degree. So this graph does not have an Eulerian cycle. So the wish of the citizen of Königsberg to take this nice stroll and cross every bridge exactly once, not possible. So again, this is a very easy algorithm, right? Visit all the nodes and check that every node has an even degree. What about Hamiltonian cycle? Can we do this in polynomial time? So one thing we could do, we can enumerate all the possible cycles and check whether they are Hamiltonian cycle. They visit every node exactly once. Well, that's n squared, that's n factorial, that's a very large number. If you're a bit smarter, you can come up with what we call dynamic programming algorithm. I won't get would say exactly what it is. This will be in 2 to the n. So let's take a graph with 200 nodes. So the number is 2 to the 200. 2 to the 200 is roughly somewhere around 10 to the 68 or something like that. That's a big number. That's a very big number. Imagine a computer that you start running it when the big bang is happening. You start running the machine. And you have a very fast machine. It can execute an operation every Planck time constant. A Planck time constant is, I think, 10 to the minus 44 of a second. Okay? This machine would not yet finish finding a Hamiltonian cycle in a graph with 200 nodes. So 2 to 200 is a very large number. But this is just the algorithm that we know how to do. Can we solve it in polynomial time? That's an open question. Now, if somebody gives you a candidate cycle and you want to check it is Hamiltonian cycle, it's very easy to check. You need to check that you visit every node exactly once, and you always go across edges in the graph. So checking is easy. We can do it in linear time. And it turns out that there are many problems that if you give me a proposed solution, I can check whether this is a solution very easily. Okay? And for example, think of factoring in numbers. It's a hard problem. If you give me a factorization, all I have to do is multiply the two factors, see whether it gives me the original number. It's a quadratic algorithm. So it turns out there are tens of thousands of problems that have this feature that are easy to check. And these are called NP, for non-deterministic polynomial time. The name is not too intuitive, but that's what it means, easy checking. And you find the problem in all areas of life, in engineering, in logistics, in semiconductors, in biology, everywhere you find these problems are in NP. So the P versus NP question asks a very simple question. Is checking easier than discovering? P are the problems that we can discover the solution in polynomial time. NP are the problem where we can check solution in polynomial time. Is checking easier than discovering? So the intuition here, well, surely checking is easier than discovering. Even think of the language that we're using. Finding a needle in a haystack. We think this is difficult. Suppose there is a big haystack, and I tell you, the needle is here. All you have to do is look and see, is the needle there? It's easy. So we think that checking, intuitively, we think checking is easier than solving a problem. Think of if you ever do Sudoku. Checking Sudoku is trivial. Solving it is difficult. Think the difference between coming up, if you ever have to come up with a proof. Coming with proofs is hard. Checking proof, much easier. So our intuition is that checking is easier, but we don't know how to prove it. So we can imagine the following different possible worlds. In one world, P is different than NP, and we cannot solve. There are many problems that are difficult to solve. On the other hand, RSA inscription depends on the difficulty of factoring. So at least we can think that RSA is probably safe. So why is it so important to prove, if it's so obvious to us that P is different than NP, why do we need to actually prove it? And in fact, when I was a researcher in IBM Almaden Research Lab, they just this week celebrated 30 years of its 30th birthday, happens this week. One day, one of the researchers who worked with the director of the lab came to me and said, the director has a question. I said, sure. The director was a physicist. And he told me, the director understands that you guys believe that P is different than NP. I said, yeah, this is the common conventional wisdom is P is different than NP. He said, so the question is, why don't you just accept it and move on? Which is what physicists do, right? You accept it, no offense. You accept it and you move on until evidence to the contrary emerges. So why are we trying so hard to prove it? Because we think if we cannot prove it, it really means that we do not understand it. So it's not so much we want to prove it to find out it's different, because without a proof, we don't understand it. And then it's always possible, maybe it is equal. Maybe somebody broke RSA, and they're just not telling us. Whoever is the bad guy, choose your favorite bad guy, and they actually prove that P equal NP, and they broke RSA. RSA is a public key cryptography system, very well known. And so unless we have a proof, we don't know that this is not the case. So let's try imagine a universe where P equal NP. Scott Aronson, used to be at MIT, now he's just moved to University of Texas in Austin, wrote about it in his blog as follows. He wrote, if P equal NP, then the world would be a profoundly different place than we usually assume it to be. There would be no special value in creative leaps, no fundamental gap between solving a problem and recognizing the solution once it is found. Everyone who could appreciate a symphony would be Mozart. Everyone who could follow step-by-step group a proof would be Gauss. So if P equal NP, then on one hand, we can solve efficiently many, many important problems. On the other hand, we can factor numbers also, and therefore RSA is not safe. Is it possible that we equal NP? Absolutely, it's possible. In fact, there are many other problems. Take, for example, linear programming that people thought it was a difficult problem, and eventually it was shown that it's in polynomial time. Now, it took 40 years before it happened. So somebody could come up with a very clever algorithm to solve NP complete problems in polynomial time. It's possible. Now, the NP complete problems are the hardest problem in NP. In a formal sense, they are the hardest problem. Hamiltonian cycle is NP complete. And that means that P equal NP, if and only if Hamiltonian cycle is in polynomial time. There are thousands of NP complete problems. What this tells us is that if you want to prove that P equal NP, it's enough to prove that one of them is in polynomial time. In fact, Hamiltonian cycle, it's a favorite problem. There are people who try to prove that it's in polynomial time. There is this guy in Guelph, in Canada, and every year he publishes a new proof that P equal NP because Hamiltonian cycle is in polynomial time. And he doesn't give up. Every year we expect to see a new proof, P equal NP, from him. There is a nice website of all the wrong proofs that P equal NP and all the wrong proofs that P is different than NP. It makes for entertaining reading. So on one hand, we have these questions. We have all these NP-complete problems. So let's look a little bit at the history of this. So people realize that there are these problems that require heavy search. And in fact, the early research was done on this was in the Soviet Union. They had a research program they called Perebor, exhaustive search. And they were trying to understand why some problems require exhaustive search and some do not. But they made no progress on it. Until in 1971, Steve Cook developed the theory of NP completeness and proved that Boolean satisfiability, which I will visit in a minute, is NP complete. A year later, Richard Karp realized that if you have one problem, you can start doing a reduction. And he showed that there are 20 different combinatorial problems which are NP complete. And we know that all NP complete problems are polynomially equivalent. If you solve one, you can solve all the other ones. Leonid Levin, who was doing his PhD in Moscow, independently was able to prove, develop the concept, and publish a paper, like 3 pages, very, very thin paper. He proved that 6 problems are NP complete. The theory kind of developed in the mid 70s. In 1979, a book by Gary and Johnson came out. It's really a beautiful book. If you're old enough, then you've read from it and you learn complexity theory from Gary and Johnson. And unfortunately, Dave Johnson just passed away a few months ago. And then by 2000, the problem was so prominent that the Clay Institute announced its $1 million award for solving the problem. Now, how does logic figure it out? So logic as we know it today, especially Boolean logic, goes back to the middle of the 19th century, where George Boole writes a book, 1847. And his big insight was that you can treat logic algebraically. So let's read a paragraph that he wrote in introduction to his book. If an adjective as good is employed as a term of description, let us represent by letter Y all thing to which the description good is applicable, i.e. all good thing, the class of good things. So the idea is every symbol represent a class of objects. Let it further be agreed that by the combination X times Y shall be represented the class of that class of thing to which the name or description represented by X and Y are simultaneously applicable. So here Boole used the convention of doing multiplication by juxtaposition, right? We write XY to mean X times Y. And Boole realized that logical conjunction AND can be thought as a multiplication operation. And logical disjunction can be thought as an addition operation, and that's how this analogy gives us Boolean algebras. Now the Boolean satisfiability problem looks at the Boolean expression built from variables using AND, NOT, AND, OR, and NOT. And we want to assign truth value 0 or 1 to this variable. So false is 0 and true is 1. And we want the whole expression to evaluate to 1 for some values to the variables. So this expression, for example, if you take x0, x1 to be, x1 and 2 to be 0, and x3 and x4 to be 1, the whole expression evaluates to 1. Easy to see. This is, of course, only 4 variables. There are 16 possibilities. It should not be too difficult. What happens if I give you a formula with 100 variables, with 1,000 variables, with 10,000 variables, with 100,000 variables, with 1,000,000 variables? How would you go about trying to solve such a problem? And in fact, the difficulty of this, people realized only in the 19th century, way before there was any formal concept of complexity theory, people just realized it's just difficult. William Stanley Givens, who lived shortly after Boole, in fact, what we call really Boolean algebra should be called Givens algebra, the really to Givens, not to Boole. Boole only dealt with exclusive OR. And Givens realized that you get a nicer algebra if you use inclusive OR. And so Givens write, I've given much attention, therefore, to lessening both the manual and the mental labor of the process. The process is logical reasoning. And I shall describe several devices which may be adopted for saving trouble and risk of mistake. And he built logic machines. He built machines that can do logical reasoning. These machines can handle 4 variables. So if you think this is very little, I want you to see if you can do it using moving wooden pieces. That's it. No power. Just moving wood. Ernest Schroeder, he lives a little later, a German algebraist, writes, and this is to me an amazing quote, getting a handle on the consequences of any premises, or at least the facet method of obtaining these consequences, seems to be one of the noblest, if not the ultimate goal of mathematics and logic. So if you are working on SAT solving, you are working on the ultimate goal of mathematics and logic. You should feel really good about it. But only, as I said, in the early 70s, we have finally some theory that would explain to us why the problem seems to be so difficult. In spite of the difficulty, as soon as people build computers, they start to do logic, computational logic. So the first computer start to run, people are debating whether the machines that were built in Bletchley Park during World War II were full computers. But the ENIAC was the first public machines, and it was turned on in 1946. 10 years later, Newell, Shaw, and Simon already write a program called Logic Theorist, and they prove all the propositional logic theorems in Principia Mathematica, and they're so proud of themselves, they send a letter to Russell, and Russell is very pleased. There's a whole story about it. And then in 1958, Davis and Putnam write a technical report that was unpublished at the time, and they wrote it for the National Security Agency. This is the agency that does signal intelligence. And this was amazing to me that only then they realized the importance of solving Boolean satisfiability. And I always make sure that I cite this paper because I know the NSA is listening to the talk and I want to make sure they are not offended. This technical report only became public many years later. The two important papers that went public is 1960, Davis and Putnam, 1962, Davis, Logeman, and Loveland, and together this became known as DPLL, Davis, Putnam, Logeman, and Loveland. And what is the DPLL method? The DPLL method is really first convert the formula to what we call conjunctive normal form. I won't define, give a definition, but this is an example of a formula in conjunctive normal form. It's an AND of ORs with possibly with negations. And so this is a very easy format to work with. And then you just run a, what we call a backtracking search, try to make assignment. If you fail, you go up and you undo your assignment and you keep doing it. And there is one heuristic, which is if you have one disjunction, which is a degenerate disjunction, then always go on. Because if you see a disjunction that says P must be true, then make P true because there is no choice there, or make P false. This is called unit clause preference. By 1990, people have been working, developing other heuristics, and we could solve problems with maybe 100 variables. I think 2 to the 100 is still an impressive number. It was not trivial to do that. Then starting in the mid-90s, there was an explosion of new ideas and new heuristic. And today there is a collection of heuristic that people call CDCL, conflict-driven closed learning. I mean, there is no precise definition, and some people would argue what is exactly the precisely CDCL, but CDCL today is mostly what I would call modern solvers. And what are they using? They're using one is called backjumping, which is when you do backtracking, don't just go one level up, but go up as much as you can. The unit clause preference is still a very basic operation. It turned out when you do profiling, 80% of the time, that's what you do. You just follow unit clauses. And so you need to do it very, very efficiently. And so people came up with good data structure for doing very efficient unit clause preference. When a search fails, you can find usually a short explanation for why it failed, and you don't want to repeat the same assignment again. It's called closed learning. And choosing which variable to, when you do the search, you have to choose a variable and assign it 0 or 1. And how should you choose the variable? So people for years tried to choose very, very sophisticated choice that are called decision heuristic. You're deciding which variable to assign. Turn out this heuristic were very good, but each decision took too much time. And so I call it the brainiac versus the speed demon. Is it better to be smart or to be wise? Most of the people here got here because they are smart, so we think being smart is better. But then now, in life, being too smart is not good. I know it because my father always told me that I'm over smart. Whenever he was upset, he said, "You're over smart." So I know it's not too good to be too smart. And finally, sometimes you do the search and you realize, I must have made something wrong decision. Let's just forget everything and go to the beginning, start from the beginning, and this is called a restart. Let's restart the search. And so this collection of heuristic today is, and there are key tools, GRASP in the mid-90s and SHAF in around 2000. This collection of heuristic is so effective that today we can solve problems, some problems, with millions of variables. Just to show you how much improvement we have seen over the past 20 years, a colleague of mine, Sanjit Sheshia, a few years ago, took a bunch of solvers over a period of 12 years and ran all of them on a modern machine at the time, on a 2012 machine, on one benchmark. And what you can see is on this benchmark, we went from, in 2000, 800 seconds, and by 2012, it took 1 second to do it. So we got 3 orders of magnitude improvement over 12 years, and this is so impressive that people talk about Moore's law for such solvers, because they're making such impressive progress. And the progress has been such that today such solving is industrial reality. Okay? Wake up, Nikolai. I'm talking about you. You're so busy looking at the laptop, you're not listening. I'm giving you credit here. Close the laptop. So there's a nice paper in Communication of the SEM from 2012 by Leonardo De Mura and Nicolai, and they describe the idea is that also Nikolai gave a nice lecture tutorial on this, on Z3, and how it is used extensively in Microsoft for industrial software development. So as we speak now, as we're sitting here, there's a whole bunch of machines in Microsoft running such solving for industrial software development. So this is kind of, in some sense, an introduction, talks about how much progress such solving has made in the past 20 years. Now I want to zoom in on verification of hardware and software system. So hardware and software, the whole IT industry, is a huge industry. If you look at I'm not talking about every IT company. I'm talking about the companies that design hardware or software and sell it. This is an industry of about $3.25 trillion. What is the big problem when you design this system? Do they meet their intended specification? What people call it designer intent. Do they do what they are supposed to do? And verifying this is a huge part of the development effort. In fact, it's estimated to be somewhere near 70% of the whole development cost has to do with verification in the broader sense. What they call functional verification, which does it have the desired functionality? Now, many people here have spent their life, I spent much of my life, doing formal verification. Formal verification, you use mathematical techniques and you try to develop proofs, mathematical proofs that the system does what it's supposed to do. When you actually look what industry is doing and you ask how much of the verification effort uses formal verification, I don't know precise number, but my estimate it, and I once in a while I run people in industry, we do the calculation, for example, how many people do you have working on formal verification? And you find out that it's about, at most, 10% of the whole verification effort. So it's a small fraction, even though in academia it looks like this is a major activity, it's a small fraction. So what do they do in the other 90% of the verification effort? So what they use is so-called dynamic verification. And this is really the dominant approach to system verification. You simulate the system under different scenarios and you see that it behaves in the intended way. That's, in fact, if you write a program, probably that's what you do. You don't formally verify it, usually. You run it, you test it, and you say, okay, it seems to be doing what I think it's doing. That's what we usually do. Now, what is the problem? The problem is that the inputs has to cover somehow the different way the system can behave, and the space is huge that we need to cover. Just to give an idea, so some people may remember that about 20 years ago, Intel released the Pentium, and the Pentium could not divide the floating point division properly. And so Intel had a bug in the chip when it came to floating point division, and this became very embarrassing to Intel, and they had to recall the chip, had to fix it and replace the chip, and it cost them in 1995 $500 million. The estimate today it would cost $5 to $10 billion to do a similar recall because the market is much bigger today. And so people know that anybody who would release a chip with a floating point division error is going to lose their job. Okay? You can make a mistake once, but not twice. So let's imagine we're dealing with people with numbers with 28 bits. And suppose we want to check all possibilities. I mean, this is 2 to the 56. I mean, as we saw before, even 2 to the 200 is a huge number. This is an astronomical number. We cannot cover the full state space. So what do people do? So you put a lot of smart people, and you tell them, look, here's the algorithm. Think of what we call all the corner cases. What happens if one is very large and one is very small? Write test cases for all these scenarios. So in fact, I got exposed to this testing around 1990. IBM was building a disk drive and building a controller. They want to test the controller. And so they bought an emulator. An emulator is a huge FPGA array and can emulate hardware very, very fast. They had about 100 people writing test cases. A person can write about 20 test cases per day. It's like writing code. The conventional wisdom is you write about 20 lines of code per day, regardless of what language you are using. So this is similar. This is like writing code. So these 100 people would write about 2,000 test cases per day. The hardware emulator would run these 2,000 test cases in less than 1 minute. And then the rest of the day, the machine was sitting idle. And the executive that decided to buy this $5 million machine were very embarrassed. They bought a $5 million emulator, and it is busy 1 minute a day. And so they came and consulted with Richards, can we figure out a way to generate many, many more test cases so they can justify their investment in the hardware emulator. It's a long story. I made no progress on this project, but other people in IBM did, and they came up with a really beautiful idea. Instead of writing test cases, write constraints that describe the scenario. So to say, this number has to be very large, the other number has to be very small, write different sets of constraints. And now give this constraint, the constraint solver, to generate many, 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 many test vectors based on the constraints. So this approach today is the standard approach in the industry. Okay? This is what developed by 1994, Lichtenstein, Malka, and Aharon at IBM Research in Haifa. Now, if you give it to the solver, it will do what solver do and generate a solution. But the solution would depend on a specific, on the internal structure of the solver. That's not what you want. You want to get random solutions to the constraints. Not only that, the solution have to be uniform. Why? So you don't want, you know, if you're only using what the solver give you, with no guidance, then, you know, it's like searching for the keys under the lamp, under the lamppost. I mean, the keys can be anywhere. I need to check randomly everywhere. I don't know where the bug is. And because I know nothing so far about the solution space, I should search uniformly. So I want to take constraints and find solutions randomly and uniformly. So let's look at the simplest possible constraint, just Boolean constraint. Imagine you have a Boolean formula, and you know that you have good SAS solver that can give you solutions. But you want random, uniform solution. So how can we take a SAT solver and use it to find random, uniform solution? This is an important problem, uniform generation of SAT solutions. And we want to do it for large industrial problems. Turns out that this problem has many, many applications. One, we just saw, constrained random verification. I'll give you another one. So assuming you all heard about MOOCs. So this is massive open online courses. So sometimes you have courses with 100,000 students taking this. Imagine you give them homework. The first one to solve it would post a solution on one forum, and the other 99,999 students will just copy the solution. So you want to give every student a slightly different problem. How can you generate 100,000 instances of the same problem? So one way to do it is you don't give specific parameters in the problem. You write constraints to describe the relationship between the different parameters. And now you generate random uniform solutions. And you generate, with high likelihood, 100,000 different instances of the assignment. And there are many other applications as well. So it turns out that this problem, uniform random generation of solution of constraints, had been studied by theoreticians going back to the mid-80s, 30 years ago. So there's a paper by Jerome, Valiant, and Vazirani, was called Random Generation of Combinatorial Structure from a Uniform Distribution. And they describe a randomized polynomial algorithm with sigma P2 oracle. I won't get into definition what is sigma P2 oracle, because a few years later, Belari, Goldrach, and Petrank come up with a better algorithm because they can now do it with an NP oracle. What does NP oracle mean? A SAT solver is an NP oracle because it solves NP complete problems. It means you have a program, and the program can use a SAT solver as a subroutine. So the solution, you see, okay, the problem has been solved. So I got interested in this problem 10 years ago. In fact, I was at the Newton Institute for the logic and algorithms, and we had a workshop on verification and constraints, and someone from IBM came, and he gave a talk, and he said, this is what we do. I said, wow. I asked him after the talk, how do you generate random uniform solutions? He said, We really don't know how to do it. We use all kind of hacks. I said, are the solution uniform? He said, not really. Who knows what's really happening there? So I thought this was a beautiful problem. And I put it on the list. I have a long list of problems. I think about 500 research problems. One day I'll work on them. And then in 2011, graduate students, after taking my course, said, I like logic. Can I do some research with you? I said, okay, here is, let's take problem, 415 and work on it. And so the first thing we did, we took this algorithm by Bellari Goldreich-Petrank, BGP, and we said we'll implement it. We implemented it, and we could run it up to 16 variables. And I remember telling him, Kuldeep, that's his name, Kuldeep Mill, I'm very sorry to tell you, we cannot even submit it to a workshop, not a conference. If we submit to a workshop, today, people solving SAT for million variables, and we're going to submit a paper and say we can do 16 variables, we will become a laughing stock of the community. I said, we have to go to at least 100 variables because we can even think of submitting it. So we start working. We had to go back. So there was a theoretical solution. It was a non-starter. And we had to go back to the drawing board to try to find up another solution that would be scalable. Now, you can ask, okay, what do people do in the industry? You just told us that this is a very important industrial problem. So you go to industry, people have been thinking about it now since 1994. People have tried to use Boolean binary decision diagrams. I won't go into that. Binary decision diagram give you a good solution to that. You can really sample uniformly. But generally speaking, BDDs, as they're called, cannot handle more than 1,000 variables. By the time you get to 1,000 variables, these decision diagrams get to be very, very large, and they just blow up, and you cannot do it. And people need to deal with a million variables. So there are two other techniques. Some class of technique is based on what's called a Monte Carlo Markov chain, MCMC. And again, I don't have time right now to define it. The problem is this technique requires a lot of time. You basically take a random walk on a Markov chain, and you need to take exponentially many steps to reach the uniform distribution, and nobody is willing to wait that long, so people cut the walk short, and therefore they don't get a uniform distribution. Or what you do is you take your SAT solver, and you add all kind of randomization inside the SAT solvers. And you get something that may look random, but it's not really random. So when we started doing this, which was 2011, there were really no good solution. The theoretical problem were not working. The industrial solutions were either not scalable or not uniform. And we developed a new algorithm called Unigen. And what it does, it's an almost uniform. I'll define almost uniform in a minute. It's an almost uniform generation. It's a polynomial time algorithm, randomized polynomial algorithm, using SAT solver as a subroutine. We make SAT solver call. It uses two key ideas. One is called universal hashing, which is an old idea in computer science, and I explain what it is. And the other one is called SMT, which is part of the SAT technology that we are using. And we today can scale it to millions of variables, can solve really large industrial instances. And not only that, remember, this is used for testing. When you do testing, you want to do in parallel, you want to run many, many simulations. And we can do some initial computation, compute some parameters, and then we can let every server that runs the simulation generate its own samples, and they will be independent. And so you can really kind of generate it in parallel. So let's see what are the key ideas here. So the first idea is almost uniformity. We compromise. So real uniformity would be if there are kappa solution, then you want every solution to come up with probability 1 over kappa. That's uniformity, right? Every instance will have exactly the same probability. That is very difficult. But instead, let's allow ourselves to deviate from this 1 over kappa by factor of 1 plus epsilon above or below, when you choose epsilon. Of course, the smaller the epsilon, you'll have to pay a higher price. Okay, if you take epsilon to be 0.0001, that will be expensive. So you decide how close do you want to be to uniform. Okay. So this is almost uniformity. Now, what is the basic idea? So it kind of reminds me, you know, I remember when I was a learner about binary search, we were told, how do you catch a lion in the desert? You draw a random line in the desert. The lion will be on one of the two sides. You take this side, you draw another random line. Again, the lion will be one of the two sides. Eventually, the area will become very, very small, and the lion will have to stand like this because it's so small. And then quickly, you tie the lion's feet and you caught a lion. So we take this set of solutions and we split it randomly again and again, and we get cells that will have a fairly small number of solutions. Small enough that you can enumerate them and choose one of them randomly, uniformly. Now, it's very hard to do. If I had equal cells, then I will have a uniform generation. But to make equal cells is very difficult. I will have almost equal cells, or they will be equal with high probability, and therefore I will get almost uniformity. Now, the difficult question is, this is a space. Remember, this is a space of solutions. I know very little about this space. How can I take this space and divide it almost uniformly into small cells? This seems to be very difficult. Here comes the magic of universal hashing. One of the, goes back to late 70s, early 80s, one of the most beautiful ideas in computer science. So hashing is one of the most basic techniques in computer science. You have a very large, think about it, for example, you have a server and there are passwords, and the passwords are maybe, let's say, 10 characters long. So there is a large number of passwords, and you need to store them and find them. So what you do, you hash a large space, you map a large space into a much smaller space. So these techniques of mapping a very large data space into a much smaller space, we use it all over computer science. And in the early days, people says, well, we don't want a mapping that will somehow take whole area of the input space and map them into the same thing. We want to start, if we start from a roughly uniform distribution, we should get a rough of the input, we should get a roughly uniform distribution of the output. So you can go back to the old volumes of Knuth's book, The Art of Computer Programming, and you see a discussion of how to write a good hash function. The problem here is we know nothing about the initial distribution. So even if you choose a good hash function, it would work on good input distribution. It will not work if the input distribution is very skewed. So the beautiful idea of universal hash function is you have a family of hash function and you choose randomly. And randomization, we already know from game theory, it's a way to deal with incomplete information. Suppose you're going to play the game of what is called rock, scissors, paper, rock, scissors. Well, you don't know what your opponent is going to do. Your best move is always random, because randomness is the best way to deal with unknown information. So here we have a family, we choose the hash function randomly, and what the property tells us is that if you choose randomly the hash function, regardless of what the input distribution is, will be the hash values will be almost uniformly distributed. This is an amazing property. Now, how do you do that? We'll see in a minute how you do this magic of universal hashing. But there's another property that we need. So imagine I do the following. I have all this space. I choose one output value at random. Then I says, map everything to this value. Then in some sense, every input value is mapped randomly and uniformly, but they're not independent. I wanted the mapping to be independent. Now, independent is expensive. So you have to tell me how much independent do you want? And this is called R-wise universality. It tells you if you have up to R input values, they will be mapped independently. And typically, you're going to pay a price. The higher R, if you want more independence, you'll have to use more computational effort. Generally, to get R-wise universality, you need polynomial of degree R minus 1. And as the degree gets higher, this becomes more expensive. And in fact, BGP used very high degree polynomials, which was why it was so expensive to implement. So BGP used very high universality. They got beautiful distribution of the cells. All the cells were equal with very high probability, but they got uniform generation, but it was not practical. We are relaxing it. We're only going to three universality. So only when you, the three input values must be independent as they map. But that's all. We get much better performance, but we have to relax the uniformity to almost uniformity. But we can go from 16 variables to million variables. Huge difference in the performance. So what is the magic here? The magic here is XORs. What is XOR? XOR, you can think of XORs. Exclusive OR, you can think of it is addition modulo 2. So we generate random XOR constraints. What is a random XOR constraints? For every variable, with probability half you include it, with probability half you do not include it. So you get a random XOR, and then you say it's equal 0 or equal 1 with probability half. Okay, so it's a parity constraint. It's a random parity constraint. You can think of every such XOR constraints as a random hyperplane that cuts the solution space. But don't think of it as a geometric hyperplane. That would be the wrong intuition. It's this parity constraint, but it does every such random constraint split the solution space in half. If I have enough of them, I will get small cells. And every cell will be described by the initial formula plus XOR constraints. Now, I can translate XOR constraints to standard CNF. When you do that and you give it to a SAT solver, it dies. SAT solver do not perform well on XOR constraints. Now, we know that pure XOR constraints, these are just linear equations modulo 2. So if you just give me XOR constraints, I can solve it very fast using Gaussian elimination. But now I have a mixture XOR constraints and CNF. How can I solve it? Here come into the picture another technology which we call SMT, satisfiability modulo theory. So the idea here is to leverage the success of SAT solvers and combine Boolean SAT solving with constraints from another domain. For example, linear arithmetical constraints. And very quickly, so we said the SAT revolution started around 1995. And within 5 years, people realized how successful it is. When Schaff came out, it made a real splash. And people said, let's see if we can now leverage it to more expressive domains. So we leverage SAT technology, but we go to more expressive domains. We need to combine here SAT solving with Gaussian elimination, because Gaussian elimination is a good solution for XOR constraints. We were looking around. I said, we tried to do something ourselves. We got terrible performance. And then we stumbled onto a solver called CryptoMinisat. CryptoMinisat was developed to try to use SAT technology to break cryptographic keys. It was a total failure. But it did what we needed to do. So even when you have a failure, you turn out into a success in another way. It was exactly what we needed to do, because it combined the CNF solving with Gaussian elimination in a very clever way. It's a very effective solver. So this is what the tool is doing. I give you a basic overview of what the tool is doing. How good is the tool? So there are two questions. One is, how uniform is it? And so to check uniformity, this is one example. We took a formula with 16,000 solutions, and we generated 4 million samples. And now we counted every solution, how many times it gets selected. Now, of course, you don't get a uniform distribution. What you get in the limit should be a Poisson distribution. We don't get exactly Poisson because we're not in the limit. So we implemented a uniform sampler for this specific problem. And we compared the distribution of the counts between our almost uniform sampler and the uniform sampler. And we get two distributions that are statistically indistinguishable. So we get something that it looks as uniform as it can be. So even though we're using epsilon, which is not very small, we use, I think, epsilon 0.75, still we generate something that looks very much uniform. How well does it perform? So we compared against a sampler that was developed in Cornell, a kind of by using AI techniques. And this was a sampler that provided no guarantee on uniformity. And we still were able to outperform it by about 2 or 3 orders of magnitude. So we're able to get reasonable performance with almost uniform guarantee. So this is now something that we're talking to industry. What would it take to actually transfer it to industrial application. We're very close to be able to transfer it to industrial applications. Now, the success was enough that we said, can we go to a related application? And this is SAT counting. SAT counting, given a formula, you want to know how many solutions does it have. You want to count the number of solutions. Here is a formula, P or Q. You can see that it has three solutions, right? P is true, Q is true, and or both are true. There are three solutions. The counting solution of SAT formulas, this is known as sharp SAT. And sharp SAT is known to be a very difficult problem. It is sharp P complete. It is the canonical hard problem for counting problems. And we really do not, I talked about a lot of success in SAT solving, where we can solve formulas of millions of variables. With SAT counting, nothing like that. We can do it, we can solve formulas, we can see a lot of progress, but there we can solve formula with maybe tens of thousands of variables. Okay, so we are almost two orders of magnitude away from what we can do in SAT solving for SAT counting. Why is it interesting? Well, in the domain of random consent verification, before you start generating test vectors, you would like to have some ideas what is the size of the solution space. Okay? So you can estimate how much of the solution space you have, of the input space you have covered. But the killer application here is actually in machine learning, where you have essentially initial probabilistic model. In this case, it's a uniform distribution. And now there is some assertion, and you want to know what is the probability of that assertion. And the probability of that assertion is the number of solution, let's say, divided by the number of possible solutions. So counting is a way to do probabilistic inference. But SharpSAT is really a hard problem. So again, first of all, we're going to compromise. We're not going to give you the precise counting. Instead, we are going to do the same thing, which is we're going to get the count, but we're going to allow ourselves to deviate by a factor of 1 plus epsilon, multiply or divided. And in fact, we'll even relax and we'll get a randomized algorithm that will just give us the answer with a certain confidence. Okay, so you decide what is the confidence. In this case, the confidence is some parameter delta, and we want to succeed with a probability greater than delta. And this is called probably approximately correct. And if you know something about machine learning, you may have heard the word PAC learning, probably approximately correct. But before it was part of learning, PAC was part of counting, was introduced by Larry Stockmeyer. And the first algorithm published to do this approximate counting was due to Jerome Sinclair and Valiant, and they used a randomized algorithm with an NP oracle, so they had a nice theory, but again, this is completely impractical what they have done. So we went back, and the question was, can we use our techniques that is based on universal hashing? And remember what universal hashing does. It takes the input space and divides it into cells. And then we sample from a cell randomly. Instead, we can count a cell. And if we know how many solutions are in the cell, all we have to do is multiply by the number of cells and get an approximation. If we do it enough times, we'll get an approximation that is better and better with higher and higher confidence. So each probe gives us an estimate. We generate many of them. And as we generate many of them, we get better quality of approximation and higher confidence. So how good is it? So we took problem up to 50,000 variables, which we can solve using an exact counter. We use a counter called cache. And we set epsilon to be 0.75, which allow ourselves to be wrong by 75%, which is quite high. And we compare them on many dozen benchmarks. And the answer is that we are within 4% of the actual count. So even though we set epsilon to be 0.75, in reality it behaves as if epsilon is 0.04, which suggests that our analysis is not tight enough. If we could do a tighter probabilistic analysis, we're able to actually improve the analysis significantly. And the performer is that, again, cache works up to 50,000 variables. After that, so we basically know you run the cache for 5 minutes. If it come out the answer with 5 minutes, good. Otherwise, it will never come up with an answer. It will just go forever. And we can solve problems today this case, we not to millions of variables, but we solve problem with hundreds of thousands of variables, and we get approximate count. Here we can say how accurate it is because there's nothing to compare. These problems are the only way to count them is with approximate counting. So let me try now to wrap things up. So one thing that really the most important message is that the progress we have seen in such solving over the past 20 years are nothing short of revolutionary. I mean, 20 years ago, if you ask me, you know, can we do such solving on industrial problems, I would say, no way, it's NP-complete. And now we do it on a routine basis. It is not well known. I think we need better marketing. I propose deep solving. Model after what? Why deep solving? Deep learning. Everybody knows. Choose a random person in the street. They've heard about deep learning, I'm sure. I want them to hear about deep solving as well. The other point is that such solving now is an enabler. We can use it to do not only to do such solving. Okay? And in fact, in the tutorial, but Nicola, we already hear how you can use it to do many other computational tasks. I talked here about approximate sampling or counting. But generally, the rule is if you have a hammer, go look for nails. So I think we're going to look for nails. And I want to emphasize that we're not done with, it's not as if this is a solved problem. Such solving is a hard problem. We're making progress in such solving, and we need to keep making progress. Even for sampling and counting, we are continuing to make improvement in the scalability of the technique. And I want to conclude with some philosophical reflection on P versus NP. So when I was a freshman, one of the PhD students asked us in a tutorial, do you know the difference between theory and practice? We didn't know what to say. He said, look, in theory, they're not very different, but in practice, they're very different. Okay? So P versus NP. I said, it's a central problem in computational complexity, central problem in mathematics. How important is it from a practical point of view? Not clear at all. For example, it's conceivable that P equal NP, but the polynomial is going to be n to the thousand. In fact, it doesn't even have to be n to the thousand. Just imagine n to the 20. N to the 20 complexity is completely impractical. There is no interesting problem you can solve if you need to run n to the 20. In fact, it could be even linear time, which is an astronomical constant. And so it's conceivable that P equal NP, and this will have no practical significance. Also, it's conceivable P is different than NP. But maybe NP is included in P to the log n. So the same smart TA that gave us the nice thing about theory and practice. Another thing I remember from him, he asked us in one of the tutorials, do you guys know what is the limit of log n when n goes to infinity? So we said, surely we know, it's infinity. He said, no, it's about 50. He said, there's no number in the universe where log, you can do the calculation, right? 2 to the 2 to the 50 is an astronomical number. It's bigger than any number in the universe, okay? If you want to count the number of quarks in the universe, it's less than 2 to the 2 to the 50. And so an algorithm with complexity n to the log n may be much better than an algorithm with a complexity n to the 5, let's say. So it could be that P is different than NP, yet we can solve NP-complete problems in practice. So when I was a graduate student, NP-complete problems were scary problems. In fact, it took me a while to get the courage to open the Gary Johnson book because I thought this is such a scary area, you know, NP-complete. There was something almost scary about it. And the idea that we're going to try to solve this problem was just inconceivable. And I said by 1990, we can solve problems with maybe 100 variables. And indeed, SAT is a difficult problem. We know how to generate synthetic benchmark with a few hundred variables that nobody knows how to solve. In fact, people are working on some problem. There was recently a result about using SAT to solve something called Pythagorean triples, where they had less than 8,000 variables. and it took enormous amount of computation to solve it. It was much more difficult problems than industrial problems that we solve, for example, in Microsoft. So we don't really know that we don't really know which problems are hard in SAT and which problems are easy. We know that some problems are easy, some problems are hard. We don't yet have a good theory. Trying to come up with a good theory is a fantastic research challenge. In fact, some of the lectures we heard in this workshop was exactly about trying to understand the boundary between hard and SAT and easy SAT instances. But we do know that we can solve large SAT problems with millions of variables. And that completely should change our perspective about worst case complexity. And so I think we need to rethink much of the conventional wisdom in computer science. And the question is, okay, what do we do with it? There are many other things we could do that we thought were hard. And so, you know, it used to be, again, if you prove, I've proved for some problem, double exponential time lower bound, okay? And again, we thought that, okay, there's nothing you should, you know, forget about it. This was like undecidable. And now we realize that this is way too pessimistic, but we don't have good guidance, what is practical and what is not practical. And we don't have the good theory for it. And much of what right now determines practicality is simply doing empirical work and to see what works and what doesn't work. Thank you very much.
So are there any questions or comments for Professor Vardi?
When we go to the mic. Say it again?
Chess is all about in what time? Constant, right?
Right.
But it's quite difficult. As in, like, you know, you don't really know who actually has the winning strategy, like, whether black is actually the opposite, right?
So, I mean, this goes back to the boundary between theory and practice. That is to say, the questions what can be solved in principle is of theoretical interest. The reason we develop the theory is to give us guideline in the real world, okay? In the real world, you know, do we want to know, is there an algorithm that would solve all instances? We really don't care about all instances, right? We always care about instances that would come up in real life. The whole complex theory is an abstraction that is meant to give us insight on the finite world in which we live. And therefore, we go to Platonic space and we develop rich theory there with the hope that it will give us insight. So when I go to build database management system, I will know which algorithm to use. And we used to think that the theory does give us as guideline. Okay? And somehow we thought that this thing in Platonic space, I mean, I don't know if you know the paradigm of Plato's cave, but the idea is we thought we can somehow look at what happened in Platonic space and it will project well on our real world. When we're discovering the projection is not very accurate. Okay? So we can do things in our finite domain that does not seem to correlate well with what's happening in the mathematical space. And we need to develop the theory so we'll have better guidelines. I mean, when you teach an algorithms course and do analysis, you would like to tell students, look, listen, you know, you should pay attention to this analysis because it should guide you when you go to build systems. And right now, this is very difficult to say that this provides us good guidelines. So in some sense, my point is that the mathematical model, and this is true in generally, why is mathematics interesting? Because it does give us guidelines to the real world, right? So Pythagoras' theorem is true for every size triangle, but you really only care about it for, we know that it's not accurate for field that would start to be affected by the curvature of Earth. But it gave us a fantastic, if you are in Egypt, you're trying to divide, or Greek, and you're trying to divide fields, plane geometry gives you a very good guideline how to do it. And that's the kind of thing, right? We need theory, which is abstract, but project well into the practice. And that's what we are missing right now. Yes.
On the other hand, in database
Yes.
I don't have a good answer to that. What I do know is that if you look at much of what's happening in conjunctive query evaluation, it happens as if nothing happens in the world of SAT. The algorithm for the optimization, the heuristic that were developed for conjunctive query evaluation were developed when? Early 80s. I mean, there seems some new work coming up some now. But I would say most of what you see query optimization, and where is Leonid here? Most of it is, I would say, developed at the 80s at most, okay? Where all search techniques that are still used in commercial databases are based on technology developed in the 1980s at the latest. And today, today we heard, somebody gave a nice talk about how you can really think of the paradigm we learned from SAT solving and all cover other search problems. These ideas that we are seeing today, closed learning and smart branching heuristics, all of them, I cannot see that they need to have impact, in my opinion, on what's happening in databases, and they have not had so far. I think this is actually a very ripe area to try to understand what can we learn from what happened in SAT solving when we go back to some of the basic questions such as query conjunction evaluation, or select project joins, select project join queries in relational databases. Speak to the mic. Go down one level. Go down. Okay, much better. So, this is a very good question, and people have looked at the question, can we parallelize SAT? And the answer is sometimes, depend on the problem. So the CDCL solver that I discussed, they do not seem to parallelize well. Somehow people do it and they said, well, at the end I just end up with many, many nodes, but they all run at the same time. Right? I'm not really saving time. But CDCLs are incredibly effective, but they are not the only such solvers. I mean, they are the most dominant right now, but there are certain problems that do not respond well to CDCL solvers. And there are other type of solvers. For example, there's something called look-ahead solvers. And for some problems, they are more effective. And this solver actually are easier to parallelize. So the recent work by Marion Hule on Pythagorean triple used massive parallelization. That's the only way, was the only way to solve the problem. And they have a technique called cube and conquer. And they split it in a very big way to many, many thousands of instances. And he used a huge cluster. There is in Houston, there is a huge cluster that you can go and run many thousands of cores. That's how he solved the problem. Yeah.
So you showed a graph of showing your approach.
Mike. So people actually have looked at this, and one way people have done it is you simply you put the kind of the solution space on a grid, and you put just points where you hit solutions, and you just eyeball it, and you see, does it look uniform? Does it have bald spots and hot spots? And so this is one way you can see people have done it, and you see that. Extra sample prime produce lots of bald spots and hot spots. We actually try to, we have a discussion with some EDA company, and we said, let's compare, they have a tool, they have a working industrial tool. And they said, why don't we do a comparison on uniformity? And we said, let's work and publish a paper together. And they got very excited. Then they went to management, and management says, no way. We have customers. We cannot come to go and tell the customers, look, our tool is not very good. Okay, thank you all very much.
So Professor Vardi has given us a very interesting and I would say enlightening talk on the question of PN versus NP and all the practical issues that come with that problem. Now, before we end this session, IMS would like to present to Professor Vardi some tokens of appreciation. One is a mathematical name card. The other one is a coffee mug that we printed on it, P equals MP, question mark.
Okay.
And we hope that this will encourage Professor Vardi to solve the problem.
Thank you. My pleasure.
So this lecture series is kindly supported by the Nkombeng Memorial Fund. And we thank you all for coming, and good night.